This morning's, this morning's psalm is Psalm 41. And it reads, "Happy are those who consider the poor. The Lord delivers them in the day of trouble. The Lord protects them and keeps them alive. They are called happy in the land. You do not give them up to the will of their enemies. The Lord sustains them on their sickbed. In their illness, you heal all their infirmities. As for me, I said, O Lord, be gracious to me. Heal me, for I have sinned against you. My enemies wonder in malice when I will die and my name perish. And when they come to see me, they utter empty words while their hearts gather mischief. When they go out, they tell it abroad. All who hate me whisper together about me. They imagine the worst for me. They think that a deadly thing has fastened on me, that I will not rise again from where I lie. Even my bosom friend in whom I trusted, who ate of my bread, has lifted the heel against me. But you, O Lord, be gracious to me and raise me up that I may repay them. By this I know that you are pleased with me, because my enemy has not triumphed over me, but you have upheld me because of my integrity and set me in your presence forever. Blessed be the Lord, the God of Israel, from everlasting to everlasting. Amen and amen."
Thank you. amazing love is truly a powerful force that works in our lives and flows through us into the lives of other people. So we're just blessed to have that amazing love available to us free of charge. And there every day, every minute of every day. So God bless you guys for being here. A few announcements. We've got our Wednesday night Bible study that we just started at the Hampton. And it's on discipleship led by Victoria. And next Sunday night, we've got our Bible study at Ray's house.
Yeah, next week.
Next Sunday night, so we're pleased about that. Of course, the youth are meeting every Thursday night as well, so we've got that going on. So we've got a men's retreat coming up in October. A few walks to Emmaus coming up as well. I'll start posting those dates. It's the last weekend in September, I think, for the men, and the first weekend in October for the women. And the walk to Emmaus are great opportunities for spiritual growth. Okay, so just keep that in mind. Quite a few of us have gone on the walk to Emmaus already. And I think Ted's doing the men's. Is that right? You're working the men's?
Yes.
And that's the last weekend in September.
41st,
yeah. Whatever. Yeah. And I'll be doing the women's walk as well in October. So. We're glad to have Quinn speaking for us today. Oh, my gosh.
I went to the Hampton Inn.
Yes. Oh, my gosh.
Did she get free coffee?
All the way from Tennessee. You want to introduce yourself? Let everybody know who you are.
Hi, I'm Jean.
Jean?
Yeah.
Jean? Jean? No, no, not Jean. Jean, the dancing machine. No, no, no. Good to see you.
I found you. I have some lady at the desk. Where did you go?
Yeah, sorry about that. Yeah, good to see you. But Quinn's speaking for us today. So, Quinn, good to have you. So glad to have you here. We also have a birthday to celebrate. Tegan, how old are you now? Huh?
How old are you?
Eight.
Whoa.
Oh my gosh.
Eight. You're ready to get a job.
Yeah. You're getting ready to babysit. So let's sing. Any other birthdays? I think we got them all. So, all right, Tegan. So happy birthday, Tegan.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Tegan.
First of all, my oldest grandson, Rory, is going to be getting married.
Oh, my gosh.
And that's not all.
Uh-oh.
We're going to be great grandparents.
Not Rory.
And on top of that, six months ago, my cancer markers started going up. 3 months ago, they were up even higher. Well, they just checked them again, and they're back down below where they were 6 months ago.
Amen.
Yay! It's been good news week.
Yeah. Someone dropped a bomb somewhere? Contaminating atmosphere.
So we're hoping and praying that Ray gets better and stronger, and so he can get to speak again for us, to preach. So we always like to have him.
I think the acupuncture is helping.
Okay.
It's a neat thing.
Yeah, a lot of people use acupuncture. Any other announcements? God's been working in your lives? I know Mike just shared with me how God's working in his life through his son. Is that right?
Yeah, my son, we went out for a family reunion, and not only was he a completely different person, he's always stressed, he was unstressed, he was fun, but I don't know if you all know, he had two-thirds of his colon removed a year and a half ago with throat surgery, and he made a plan, and he got a game plan, he was going to get reattached sometime in October. They're going to put him back together, I guess.
But he was a good man for 5 days.
No, he was great.
So what did I tell you? When the Lord works through you, he's going to work through other people's lives as well. He flows through you into other people's lives.
And he works, and his girlfriend is back at home. She hasn't been kicked out yet.
So now it's working through him, through her.
Oh, yeah. Okay?
So that's how God works. He flows through us into other people's lives.
Yeah.
All right. Good stuff. All right, who's up? It
looks
like.
I think it's me.
I know.
Nobody else is jumping up there.
Seriously, put the schedule out. Who's standing?
All the emails are.
All the emails are.
We
We begin our worship in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Love the Lord your God.
With all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength, and with all your mind.
Love your neighbor as yourself.
With all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your strength, and with all your mind.
Do this, and you will live.
Let us worship God.
Remain standing for the opening hymn. Trusting in that gracious love, let us confess our sin before God and one another.
Holy God, we are your sons and daughters, descendants of the God Most High, yet we do not behave to honor you, and our actions belittle the love you have for us. We do not defend the weak or those without fathers or mothers. We do not uphold the poor or the oppressed. We do not commit to efforts to rescue the weak and the needy. We sometimes deliver them into solitude and neglect. Rise up to judge us, O God. We prefer your merciful justice than living with guilt and fear. Straighten our paths so that we can be guided as a mother or a father guides the beloved children. Amen.
Hear the good. good news. Christ is merciful to all who turn to him in repentance. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven.
Thanks be to God.
Grace and peace to you. Grace and peace to one another. Grace and peace to the world. Let us share the peace today as we pass the peace of Christ. Please share the peace with one another.
Amen.
The first lesson is from the 19th chapter of Leviticus, verses 9 through 18. When you reap the harvest of your land, you shall not reap to the very edges of your field, or gather the gleanings of your harvest. You shall not strip your vineyard bare, or gather the fallen grapes of your vineyard, and you shall leave them for the poor and the alien. I am the Lord your God. You shall not steal, you shall not deal falsely, you shall not lie to one another, and you shall not swear falsely by my name, profaning the name of your God. I am the Lord. You shall not defraud your neighbor, you shall not steal, and you shall not keep for yourself the wages of a laborer until morning. You shall not revile the deaf or put a stumbling block before the blind. You shall fear your Lord God. I am the Lord. You shall not render an unjust judgment. You should not be partial to the poor or defer to the great. With justice, you shall judge your neighbor. You shall not go around as a slanderer among people, and you shall not profit by the blood of your neighbor. I am the Lord. You should not hate your heart any one of your kin. You should not reprove your neighbor, or you will incur guilt yourself. You should not take vengeance or bear a grudge against any of your people, but you shall love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord. Amen. The second lesson is from Colossians chapter 1, verses 1 through 14. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God, and Timothy, our brother, to the saints and faithful brothers and sisters in Christ of Colossae, grace to you and peace from God our Father. In our prayers for you, we always thank God, the Father of our Lord Christ, Jesus Christ, for we have heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and of the love that you have for all the saints, because of the hope laid up for you in heaven. You shall hear of this hope before in the word of the truth, the gospel that has come to you. Just as it is bearing fruit and growing in the whole world, so it has been bearing fruit among yourselves from the day you heard it and truly comprehended the grace of God. This you learn from Epaphras, our beloved fellow servant. He is a faithful minister of Christ on your behalf, and he has made known to us your love in the Spirit. For this reason, since the day ye heard it, we have not ceased praying for you and asking that you may be filled with the knowledge of God's will and all spiritual and wisdom and understanding, so that you may lead lives worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing to him, as you bear fruit in every good work and as you grow in the knowledge of God. May you be strong with all the strength that comes from his glorious power, and may you be prepared to endure everything with patience while joyfully giving thanks to the Father who has enabled you to share in the inheritance of the saints in the light. He has rescued us from the power of darkness and transferred us into the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. Here ends the lessons. Please stand for the gospel.
And the Holy Gospel is from Luke 10. It's the Good Samaritan, probably the best known text out of the Bible worldwide. Just then a lawyer stood up to test Jesus. And, "Teacher," he said, "what must I do to inherit eternal life?" And he said to him, "What is written in the law? What do you read there?" He answered, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your strength, and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself. And he said to him, you have given the right answer. Do this and you will live. But wanting to justify himself, he asked Jesus, and who is my neighbor? Jesus replied, a man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell into the hands of robbers who stripped him, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. Now by chance, a priest was going down the road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. So likewise, a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, while traveling, came near him, and when he saw him, he was moved with pity. And he went to him and bandaged his wounds, having poured oil and wine on them. And then he put him on his own animal, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day he took out 2 denarii, gave them to the innkeeper, and said, take care of him. And when I come back, I will repay you whatever more you spend. Now which of these three do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of the robbers? He said, the one who showed him mercy. And Jesus said to him, go and do likewise. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please be seated. Looking really good there, buddy.
Thank you.
Yeah, it's been good.
I feel like I talk about the weather every time I get up here, but it's like, and most of the time that's tacky, but I think that in Chicago, because of the way the weather is here, I think it's,
yes,
you know, newsworthy every time. But speaking of that, yeah, things have been going good with the walking. I love the summer because right now, especially in Morby's, I'm terrified of thinking about the winter right now, because I'm just now getting back up. You know, I was telling Frank yesterday, we were on our way to the gym, and I'm like, wow, I haven't walked around here. You know, in that gym, because I got a new membership, because I'm like, I need some time away from this one after the fall. I'm walking out, I'm like, man, you know, there's something about this. And he's like, it feels safe, doesn't it? Like, you can step without moving. And I'm like, yeah, that's pretty much what it feels like. But I love the summer because there's no ice, but I'm a leather jacket guy, so, you know, there's that trade-off in there. But, yeah, overall, I mean, has anyone been enjoying this good weather? Because I know we were kind of rainy for a while, but any fun 4th of July stories? Anyone blow up with fireworks?
Just enjoyed them.
Yeah. Anyone see any particularly good fireworks?
Well, if you go out to Nebraska, you stand on a hill, fireworks illegal, you see fireworks all night.
My parents' dog, Chloe, they can't go see fireworks anymore because the dog will go bomb shelter under the, you know, hide under, like those old movies, get under the desk, does that right under the bed every time, shake it. So I've never met a dog that really likes fireworks, never one. We got to see, on our balcony, we got to see fireworks shows all, because we're 4 stories out, so we could see them all over.
Yeah, I see that too, in town.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so we got to see them all over town, which was fun because, you know, we were lazy, we don't want to go out, especially in hot summer days. But so let's start with, so there's this verse, Psalm 86:11, that really kind of stuck out to me, and that's kind of what happens is, you know, I'm bumbling through my day, and then God shotguns me in the back of the head with a verse that's like, this is what you're talking about.
Amen.
And so it goes, teach me your way, O Lord, that I may walk in your truth. Unite my heart to fear your name. And there's so much that's packed into that, which, I mean, in reality, the Bible is just jam-packed completely anyway. I mean, there's so many lessons to be learned. And even, you know, you can go through hours and hours of Bible study on a single passage, on things like that. And it's kind of funny because one of our members of the youth group, Oscar, he's very special because he is one of the few people, and you'll meet these people throughout your life that just have a million questions, but in a good way, right? Like, especially Bible study is great for that because, you know, it shows he's hungry for it, right? He's on fire for the Lord. But what's great about him is him and me have such different cultural lives. You know, he's a lot into, you know, Japanese cartoons and video games and things like that, and I'm more into, like, you know, before my parents were alive. And so, you know, we got a little difference there, but so he'll bring up these cultural things to tie it to the Bible, and I'll have to sit there and I'm like, where did he make these connections? But it's so fun because he works so differently than me. But he, one of the things we were talking about one time, he's like, well, each of the Gospels have the same, you know, the story here is the same, but they're slightly different in each one. And he's like, well, let's look at it. And I tell him, I go, well, you know, every word is purposely chosen, right? You can glean something. The Bible's written very meticulously. And then, you know, I'm reading this verse, and I've talked to him about it, and then he just parroted the same thing back at me, and I'm like, well, dude, this is going... And it's kind of funny how your words can kind of come back around to you eventually. And so in my head, all I'm hearing is Oscar saying, you know, you're going to have to take some time to look at this verse, because it was really gnawing at me. And so what really was bugging me about this verse was, like, walking in truth, right? What exactly does that mean, walking in truth? Because that's not the same thing as saying things that are true. Living non-deceitfully, walking in truth, there's something more to that. What is being in truth that is really different? And maybe it's just the word walking, because this is kind of a new concept to me again. But it's more than this, just having a right idea in our head or orienting ourselves a certain way. Walking in truth, I think, from what I've kind of looked into after that, it's a little more than that. It's reflecting your true belief, and it's more of an example. It's more than just an example of an opinion, right? Being... living in truth is not just holding the correct opinion, because that I think that falls a little short. And so, in the world that we currently live in, there are situations where something's easily solved by a fib, right? We've all been in those situations, right? Every time, Frank comes out, you know, let's say he comes out of his room and I come out, without fail, every morning, I always bug him. I don't consider it bugging because I need the help, but like, you know, it is. I come on, I'm like, dude, how do I look? How's my hair look, dude? I can't see. I got like 4 mirrors going. I can't see it. Every morning, he's not a morning guy. Like he does work in the morning, but if I try to talk to Frank in the morning, I get a stern look. So
in the afternoon.
Yeah, even if my hair doesn't look quite good, I can understand where Frank might feel the need to just say, yeah, it looks fine, just to get me away, because without coffee, I'm a lot to handle, especially in the morning. There's bad people all over who are, you know, lying, cheating their way to the top, right? You know, that's what we're told all the time, and so why tell the truth, right? We're seeing all over the place that Frank can get me out of his face with a little white lie. There are people making money on lies, right? So what's the benefit to telling the truth? And you know, there's actually quite a few reasons why telling the truth is great, but bless you. But before we get into that, I wanted to kind of define exactly what truth is, because before we can figure out what walking in truth is, we kind of got to break down what truth is. And so truth can seem straightforward, but to me, I think it's up there with love as far as the most misused or misunderstood words in the English language, because like love, I was talking to Frank about burritos on the way here, right? It's like, Frank's like, I love burritos. I love burritos too, but there are different, you know, words for love in different languages that mean different things, right? Like the same way I love my brother and my sister, but I wouldn't, you know, trade them for a burrito. Yeah. Now, if you start asking me from where, then we have a conversation, because like, Chipotle is not authentic, but I mean, Emma bugged me at Chipotle burritos never bugged me before, so. Truth is not what feels good. Right, a lot of people think that truth is a positive word generally, and so people say truth is what feels good, but it's not. It's what is good, right? It's self-sufficient in that way. And so, what does that mean to us? It means that, you know, who are we to think we know truth alone, right? I mean, we're such fallible creatures. We stumble through a lot of stuff. So who are we to think that we can find out what truth is alone? And the Bible tells us not to lean on our own understanding for that exact reason. We're fallible creatures, so what we might see as truth can change day to day, and so we're not supposed to rely on what we think. And so, people's understanding of truth, this idea of truth, I think, is changing drastically in today's culture. People are searching for definition and belonging and happiness. Happiness is the big one, right? And that's pretty much everyone's only concern nowadays. And the thing is, the truth is interesting because it doesn't confirm your lifestyle choices. Like, the thing that came to my mind was, there are these videos going around nowadays of young people, and I like to pretend like I'm not in that generation of people, because I look online and I'm like, guys, you're eating Tide Pods. Like, what are you doing? Went to high school for 4 years, and that's basically what I learned, is don't eat Tide Pods. And I don't even know how to write a check, really. But I know not to eat Tide Pods. They got me on that one in public school. I learned that one pretty good. But there's one, these videos, these kids, and they're going around and they go to like a convenience store. And they're just walking, you know, past the milk, and they just grab the milk and just whip it across the wall and just, and then run out. And they videotape it because they think it's funny, and you know, and that's what, you know, oh, this is what makes me happy. It's funny, so it's okay. Oh, it's not really that bad, or, you know, stuff like that. Or the game where you, and admittedly, it's, I mean, being in fast food for so long, it's not as funny to me, but it's still, you know, I chop a little bit. That idea where you get a drink from a person in a drive-thru and you toss it back at them and drive away. Horrible, horrible stuff. And but see, that could be what someone says, oh, it's no big deal. It's just, you know, it's just fun. It's just harmless stuff. That's them trying to make their version of truth okay, right? It's confirming their lifestyle. The truth doesn't do that. It doesn't make you feel good on its own, because truth is not relying on our opinions or our happiness, right? It's not something that, you know, we're always going to be pleased with all the time. And so, you know, truth is self-sufficient because it doesn't need our input, right? God is that way, and God is referred to a lot as being synonymous with truth, because in the same way that God created us not because he needs us, truth doesn't need us either. It's there whether we acknowledge it or not. And one of the examples I thought of was the garden in the movie or book, wherever you saw it, The Shack. We looked into that a while ago. Still one of my favorite books, but there's a part in it where the Holy Spirit is in this garden and talking to the main character and basically looking at a poisonous plant. And the main character said, well, that's bad because it's poisonous. And then the Holy Spirit says, well, just because it's, you know, seems inherently dangerous or there's something negative doesn't necessarily mean it's bad. It just means you don't have the full perception yet, because this poisonous plant can also be used to make medicine. And so there's kind of a double-edged sword to everything in the world. And so truth is like that very much, because it's useful in one way because it tells you what really is and you can orient yourself in the world where you're following truth. But the other side of that is sometimes it's not the most pleasing thing to hear, right? I'm itching to get out, get a, you know, donut and head to work. Frank's like, tell me the truth. Ah, dude, your hair's a little messed up. That's not easy for me to hear, because now I gotta, you know, not eat my donut in the morning. I gotta skip breakfast, but I gotta look good for work. And so it's not always the thing you want to hear or what's good, but I mean, you know,
it does look good today.
Thank you, thank you. I made sure of that. I did ask Frank this morning too, like clockwork. He kind of go, hey man, open the door, crack. Hey man, still in my underwear. Hey man, this is super important for me. I can't even dress yet. I gotta make sure I look good. And so for us to think that we could find this truth alone, I think it's a little silly, because we barely know ourselves, right? You know, we day to day, we're still learning new things about who we are. We're still growing. I mean, not until our final day on this earth are we, you know, complete and growing. And so to think we can figure out all the truths of the world is pretty crazy to me. And so, you know, I think a lot of it is, an element of it is a self-esteem issue, because, you know, there's this idea nowadays that every kid is special and every kid gets a trophy. And yes, every kid is special, but I think we're missing the mark a little bit, where it's not because of them, it's not because of me. I'm not a special boy like my mommy says so, because of what I'm doing. It's because God made me unique. And so it's kind of, we're taking this, like, the glory from God and putting it into ourselves. And then, you know, that might feel good in the moment, but, and then you start to realize, oh, wow, you know, I'm not perfect. I've done a lot of things wrong. And then the shine comes off the apple a little bit, right? But when you say, you know, I'm going to rely on God. I don't need to, you know, find the truth myself. I'm going to allow God to tell me the truth. You then glorify God by kind of saying, hey, I'm not the best thing out there. You know, my mom thinks so, but that's because she's my mom. She's supposed to think so. And so we're not called to rely on our own understanding of what the truth is, but be patient and wait for God's guidance to the truth. So, because we might not have the whole truth, right? We might not have the whole situation down. And so instead of trying to reason it out ourselves all the time, maybe say, all right, I'm just going to step back and let this one go, right? I'm going to see where it goes, which is hard to do, right? We always want our hands in all the business, because that's kind of the way we are as humans. We like to work around our environment. And so being patient is really important, because generally the right path is when we're patient and wait for the right answers to come. I'm really bad with this because I have ADHD and I want immediately to do something. So as soon as two paths come up, I'm like, choose this one, choose this one, choose that one. When if I wait 10 minutes, a sign might pop on and says, the right one's probably the better one, but I'm just quick on the jump. And that's why we gotta be patient, because sometimes you can find yourself on a path somewhere you didn't even know you were going. So it's really important to remember that. And truth is more complex than this, you know, happiness or not lying or you know, simple things like that. It's more of a force in the world, because it permeates every part of our life, right? If you tell someone lies constantly, your relationship is going to reflect that. Your, you know, the way that even when they shoot you a text message, if you're on a rocky situation like that, even if you're the one doing the lying, right, where you're not the one being betrayed, you're going to still have that weird feeling, oh, okay, I got like 15 things I gotta remember that I told them that's not really true. And it's just, so it's not just about not being truthful, because you, that whole not being truthful thing then spills into every other part of that relationship or every other part of that part of your life. And so, you know, it's kind of really important to learn that truth is kind of deeper than simple words, right? And we talk, the Bible talks a lot about how words have power. I mean, even God spoke the world into creation, so that's why we've got to be really careful. You know, I think it says, no human can tame the tongue, I think is the way that works in there. But it's, you know, before we dive into that truth, I wanted to bring up this interesting point about sin. I heard this, I never knew what sin meant. I always thought it was just, you know, a word, but sin is actually an archery term, and it's it means to miss the mark of the bullseye. And I think that's a very excellent kind of word for sin, because that's what we are. We're missing the mark when we sin, right? We're not perfect because we're not hitting that bullseye. And, you know, the truth is the opposite of that, that missing that mark. Truth is when creation is in alignment with God, meaning that creation achieves its intended purpose, where they're living in truth. That's what living in truth means, is hitting your purpose that God intended, right? So we talk a lot about nature, about how, you know, squirrels don't know why they're hiding nuts. It's to build forests, right? They think they're just doing it for their purposes, but they're for God's purposes, to create forests. And every, you know, the birds, you know, the foxes, even the little gophers that wreck people's yards, I mean, you know, they all have their purpose. And the thing is they're all acting out that natural purpose. And so they're living in, you know, right relationship with God, because they're doing the natural order of things. And we're called to do the same thing. God created us for a purpose. So when we follow God's purpose, we're in right alignment. And that's the exact opposite of missing that mark. We are dialed into that bullseye at that point. And the interesting point about that is that we're aiming creatures, right? Thomas Aquinas said that one of his proofs for God was that creatures are generally pointed towards some sort of aim, like we talked about with the squirrel hiding nuts or plants spreading pollen. They all have a job to do, and they're doing it. And that shows that there is intelligent design, a right creator. And in the same way, we have a purpose, and we're aiming creatures. The difference is that God gave us free will. So while plants, they pretty much only got one option, which is to pollinate, to spread, we actually get to choose where we aim our lives. And so it's very important to remember that we have the choice to aim for good. A lot of times we go into situations like, for example, my leg. It was very easy for me in the beginning to be like, oh, my leg's broken, whatever, this is the situation I'm in, hands are out of it, I'm just going to eat buffalo wings and chill out for a while. Now, I had such a hard time doing homework, because the first thought in my brain was, here's a chance for an out, here's an easy exit, I can put all the blame on the leg and then just say, well, things are hard right now. But you can't do that, because no point in life are you completely wrenched of all, you know, potential, you know, choice in the matter. We always, no matter what, have the choice to choose good, and that's why if we're aiming creatures, we're called to aim toward the good. And so the thing about, you know, aiming for the good is that we need to know what we're aiming at, right? Because good can mean a lot of different things to a lot of different people, right? And so truth is not only to hold a correct belief, but to bring that into every part of your life, meaning that you let it change us, man, from the inside out, like Christ says, that new nature coming out. That truth needs to be inside of you. You need to match that wavelength that God has, because, you know, all these creatures, I mean, how does all this nature work? All these beautiful plants and animals, they're all in that wavelength. They're all working and growing. I mean, I can barely keep my room straight, and God can keep an entire world and universe straight. So, I mean, he's got a wavelength that's working, and, you know, we gotta match that. And this idea is even in music. We see that in music a lot. And, you know, I'll hear Frank playing his drums, and it sounds good, so he's matching a good wavelength from his room. But me with guitar is a little slower, because I'm, you know, I'm still working on school, so I'm kind of balancing it. But the little that I've got from guitar as far as learning it is that, you know, if a song sounds pleasing, that's because it's matching, you know, a tune, a wavelength that's pleasing to you. In an out-of-tune instrument, right, it's not matching that pleasing tune, and so it's not worth much in that way. But it's not garbage, though, like an out-of-tune instrument, because a little work and a little tuning can get us, you know, to the sound we want to hear. And that's like us with others. We live in a very divisive time right now, but and it's easy to write people off, or it's easy to write a situation off saying, it's hopeless, forget it, I'm not going to put the effort in. But God has called us not only to tune our own instruments to match his wavelength, to play that song that's pleasing, but also to aid others in tuning their instruments, right? So just because we're matching God's wavelength, saying, hey, I'm playing this great song, I'm not just going to walk away and let that person struggling generally how I am, which is like, is this in tune? Is this not in tune? I don't know. We're supposed to help them do it because they might not know. And we're called to recognize that wavelength, match it, and play it with other people, right? That's the congregational, the spreading of the gospel, the community side of this relationship with God, is that we're called to play with others. Because think about a single instrument versus a symphony, right? I mean, if we're to glorify God with our praises, our lives, why only have a solo instrument playing when we can get together an entire symphony to play for him? So that's why it's so important to help others tune toward that wavelength, because if we're all doing it together, we can make even more of a beautiful sound for God than we even thought we could. And so, you know, the thing is, though, what I'm learning is you kind of need to learn how to do things. You can't just want to do things. So me learning how to tune an instrument without an app to kind of cheat is, you know, something I got to learn. Luckily, though, we have a guide to learn these things, and we have that guide in the Bible, because without guidance, truth becomes subjective, and we see that's what's going on a lot now. Because truth is what makes life move. It flows from God. We talk about that idea of goodness from God. Well, truth does as well, because, if missing the mark, if not being truthful is sin, and God is removed from sin, then, you know, God is truth. And so truth is very important to keep in our lives, because it helps us grow, right? When we live in truth, when we're truthful, the best possible outcome comes out, and even if it's hurt, it hurts us in the short run, we're better for it. We can grow because of that, and it helps put things in motion. It helps to, you know, think about, they say don't start any relationship with a lie, right? That's why online dating can be rough, because it's like, oh, no, I'm a billionaire with a yacht. I've got a great beard and a great set of hair you did there, and, you know, he's a Martian, right? That's how it usually goes. Especially on the guys do that a lot. I think that, truth is very important, because, never start a relationship out with deceit, because then everything that grows from that is, you know, there's no growth there, because you halt at some point because the deceit gets in the way. So if truth is what puts things in motion, deceit is definitely something that knocks it kind of to a halt as far as life goes. Because there's integrity in not cutting corners and being truthful, because, when we're deceitful, we may get ahead now, right? You got people that, you know, can deceive their way into friend groups or job opportunities and money and things like that. But in the end, they fall later, right? Because it catches up with you eventually. Your sins find you out, and you end up sitting there trying to, you know, write away all the lies you said, and you're like, how'd I get here? Well, you said a lot of things that weren't true. And so being patient and working toward the good is what we're called to do. And so that's much longer lasting, right? Something, truth is unique because it's very long lasting. Once truth is out there, it tends to stay there, and, you know, people try to knock it away. But the funny thing about truth is that any lie you try to use to dispel it looks kind of hollow when it's standing up next to truth, right? Yeah. That's why, you know, we have the spirit inside of us that discerns, you know, truth from deceit, as far as, you know, Christ watching out for us is with, he mentions in the Bible, right, lots of false prophets, lots of people saying wrong things. We need to be on the lookout for that. And Christ gave us a radar through the Holy Spirit to kind of help us through that. But we also need other people, because that's what's great about having a soundboard, right? You know, going up to a friend or, you know, someone from church saying, you know, I got this idea in my head, theological thought, is this sound, right? That's why God gave us each other, because we're fallible creatures. We mess up sometimes. And, you know, having strength in numbers, we're more likely to catch those little mistakes as we go. And so that's why having a community is so important, because think about any crime show, right, that we've got. We've got this guy, and he's like, I want a lot of money, but I don't want to work for it. It's super hard. So I'm going to sell drugs. I'm going to sell guns. I'm going to do this, that, and the other thing. And then he gets, like, the lavish, you know, Scarface pad. You know, I'm going to say hello to my little friend, pile of cocaine. He's living the dream. And then all of a sudden, everything crumbles instantly. Every time in the movies, it's never a slow burn, right? It's never the cops are calling him, like, 2 months later. I'm going to get you in 2 months. Be ready. No, it's always, boom, everything falls. And that's because, you know, building a house of lies, right? The Bible says, build your foundation on stone, not shifting sands, right? Don't build a life full of lies, because it's going to fall. And so maintaining lies is kind of like keeping afloat a sinking ship. Imagine you're on a little lifeboat, and a little hole pops up, you plug it, a little hole there, you plug it, soon you're running out of hands, you're running out of feet, you're playing Twister, basically, just trying to keep this thing afloat. And that's kind of how, you know, maintaining lies are, because as soon as the little hole pokes in, you gotta patch that up. But the patch is never as good as the original one, so then you're sitting there running from it. And lies are attractive, though, because they allow us to try to bend slightly reality, right? And what I mean by that is, you know, let's say Frank comes over, and I've got, and he's got this really great piece of cake in the fridge. And this is actually true. He did have cake that I really wanted, but I didn't take it. This is where the fiction part comes in. Let's say I did eat it. Let's say I was bad and I ate it. And then Frank comes up and goes, man, I'm really itching for that cake. And I'm like, oh, no. He opens up the thing, cake's gone. He goes, man, did you eat my cake? And I go, no, Josh did. Josh ate my cake. Josh ate your cake. Now, to Frank's reality, to his truth, what he thinks is reality, Josh ate that cake. But in reality, I ate that cake. So in a way, I'm almost bending his reality to fit my purpose. The thing happens, though, is that God doesn't make the world that way and just let us do that. Lies that way is snapping back. Because when Josh comes over and he gets yelled at about the cake, who's getting looked at next when Josh says I didn't have that cake? Right to me. Because there's only three of us that would eat that cake. And so when we aren't in truth, we have to hold up a lot of falsehoods. We have to manage all of that. And you know, we have to get new ones to cover the old ones, kind of like that ship example. And then soon you can't keep track. All of a sudden I'm telling Josh a lie I told Frank, and I'm losing control. I can't handle any of it anymore. And that's why, you know, lies stack up. The truth is just a singular entity. So it's important to remember that you can't keep track of lies, no matter how good you are at it. I mean, that's why, you know, those snake oil salesmen, right, they had to go town to town, because you can't keep that up forever. People know your stuff actually doesn't work. And so, if we aren't careful, we can deceive ourselves more than anyone can deceive us, or we can deceive other people, because it could be in the status of, you know, a relationship, whether it's family, friends, you know, romantic, otherwise, but we can tell ourselves things are going great, things are going bad, when in reality, they're not going the way we say to ourselves they are. Who we are, how many slices of pizza we had for dinner, that's a lie that I tell myself constantly. There's only four pieces, even though half, I don't know how half the pizza's gone, I only ate three pieces. I mean, there must be Frank, probably. I mean, if we're thrown, if we're eating each other's food at that point. You know, it can also be being right in an argument. That's a big one we lie to ourselves about, right? Where when we're all PO'd and we're walking in my room with Frank, she was eating this cake. And then you're all mad, self-righteous, like I'm in the right, but then notice how when you take the time to cool off, sometimes you start to realize, hey, maybe I'm a little wrong here and there, and that's one of the bigger lies we tell ourselves. The list goes on and on, though, and what we do when we lie to ourselves is we're building this suit of armor, and every single thing that we add to ourselves is who we are. Right? Let's say, who are you? Okay, I got a really good relationship with my family. I'm a family man, right? I'm a working man. I'm someone that, you know, volunteers at a pantry, right? These things that we you know, build up of our lives, who we are, or what you like, the things, the people you're into, right? In high school, that's a big one. You're not really into this band or that TV show. You're just saying you are to fit in, right? A lot of the times, we can lie to ourselves about who we are to fit in or to feel like we belong. But what we're doing when we do that kind of thing is we're building a suit of armor whether we like it or not. When we do it with truth, those parts are metal. The stuff that isn't true is straw, and we can build up a lot of who we are out of that, you know, dry straw that's not really any substance. And a great example of this is in 1 John 1:8. It says, if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So, I mean, you know, I love that example because this idea of living in truth, we're not in truth, we're not walking in truth. This idea of if we lie to ourselves, not only are we lying to ourselves, but our entire basis of the framework of who we are is off, because now you've got all these lies mixing with these truths. You can't be a follower of Christ and be covered in deceit, because God is truth. The Spirit that lives inside of us is truth, so you can't have it both ways. You can't have one foot in the pool, one foot out, because you got to make that decision. And if we deny that there's a goal there to achieve, right? If we say we're perfect, we're good just the way we are, we don't need to move forward, we're not in alignment with God's will, because we deceive ourselves and we add another layer of that straw to kind of make up who we are. And so the truth in Christ teachings that we learn in the Bible and acts of betterment, whether that's, you know, spending more time praying, spending more time communing with other people, or even, you know, self-help stuff like less caffeine, less pizza slices, you know, things like that. All of these things, they burn away that suit of straw that we built. So And that can be painful, right? You're in the suit, it's burning, but you're burning away all the stuff you don't need that's holding you back, that's slowing you down. And it can be painful, but it's the best thing for us. And many people, they run off the path that Christ makes for us because they're afraid of what will be left, right? Well, this suit of straw, it's kind of stupid, but it's all I have, right? I don't want to burn it. It's all I have. What if I'm only left with a little piece of metal? Because that's the only thing true about me, right? A lot of people are surprised with how little of themselves is actually based in truth. Some people can live their whole lives just living in deceit, lying to people, and it just builds up. And then when they actually make that step and they actually accept Christ, they look around and they go, wow, I just had this little thing. It's all that was really true of me. But there's a beauty in that because then there's that opportunity to start over again. That, okay, now all the stuff is gone. We got all the good wheat in, chaff's gone, start from go, right? And that's a beautiful thing because in life you don't get many second chances, and Christ gives that to us. That no matter how much of this stuff we've stockpiled, he can say, all right, I'll get the movers in, we'll move all the stuff out of here. It might be a bit of work, but we're going to do it, right? And he's going to be there for you. But sometimes it's still too scary for people. And I mean, one of the examples that comes to my mind is imagine that there's this path going up the hill. Immediately, I'm already starting to get out of breath thinking about that. But there's a path that's going up a hill, right? We've got a lot of, you know, jagged steps, some hills in there, some valleys. You know, it doesn't look like easy trek upwards, right? So what do people do? A lot of people say, well, it looks like a rough trek. Maybe there's an easier path around, even though we've been told this is the path to go. So people decide, I'm just going to go into the brush right here. I'm going to go around and see if there's an easier path. So you're stumbling around, you know, got your machete cutting through the wilds trying to get to a new path. All of a sudden, you find a bunch of hooligans, ruffian people, highwaymen, Good Samaritan story, and they start chasing you around because you're not the path you're supposed to be. And now, what are you doing? Now you're running from a problem that you put yourself in, and then you're running through the untamed woods. You're not on a path because God gave us a path and you follow it. And now what happens is we're spending all our energy running from the problem we got ourselves into that we have no energy left to search for that path anymore. So we're just running in circles. And that's how lies and deceit happen. They build up. And they, you know, try to get there. As we try to get there faster, try to cut corners, right, they start to build up. And so we're using all that energy to stay ahead of the consequences instead of actually using that energy to better ourselves. And so, and that's the problem because, you know, not living in truth is not just a state of being, but it's almost like a prison because you start to get stuck in the loops of your lies and your deceits. And then, you know, it's not about just choosing that path. You got to figure out what that path is to start with because now you're so far off, and that's why ministering to people is so important because sometimes they can't find that path. And you've got to, you know, you're walking that path and you look, you see a person-shaped hole in the brush over there. You're like, yeah, okay, I could probably help someone out over there. And so that's why we're called to be, you know, very aware of people around us because, you know, there's always opportunities to help people out and to help people grow. And so whether you're lying or deceiving, it's like forcing an outcome when you think about it because, you know, Frank, if I don't want Frank to know that I ate his cake, then what do I do? Well, I can tell him the truth, then he knows that I ate his cake. So I'm forcing outcome. I'm forcing Frank to not know that I, you know, didn't eat his cake. But that's fear of letting go and letting the current of truth take me because, one, I'm not sure that truth is going to take me. What I do know is Frank's going to be mad at me, and I don't want that. So I'm afraid to let go of that and let it happen what's going to happen. And so the truth isn't always easy. It can be very intimidating. Frank can be intimidating, especially when I take away his cake. Don't do that. Let's cake. And so truth is more powerful than lies, right? The Bible tells us the darkness will never overcome the light. And lies are constantly having to be patched, right, and worked on, like we talked about with that boat. So they're weak, where truth, you can't really knock down truth because truth is, like we said, self-evident, where it is, and it's going to be there, and it's going to be what it is. And so the right thing isn't always easy, but living in truth means hard choices. Living in truth means avoiding temptations like cutting corners, like taking, you know, hey, Quinn, you know, I run the books here at work, and I'll give you a little extra if you just help me doctor these. Living in truth is hard because that cash could buy me more cake and, you know, more fun stuff. But you got to know that, you know, just because then I might lose my job completely, then that extra money that I got wasn't really worth it, right? Truth is generally, you know, in the long run, a safer bet. And so, you know, even immediate gratification, right? Young people like me are very bad with that. Immediately, you know, if my phone's slow, it's the end of the world. I'm like, you know, I'm sitting here just this morning, and I hate that this happens to me still, but, you know, I'm still 23, so it still happens, but I'm sitting there, and Frank's like, dude, how are you, like, because we went to get coffee, so I was on my regular route here, And my phone's slow. I'm sitting there, I'm like, come on, circuit center, circuit center. And my phone was just doing the pinwheel, waiting for the GPS to go on. And Frank's just like, dude, let's just go. I'm like, no. And it was just everything to me in that moment was my phone's being slow. And so fighting immediate gratification helps because, you know, if we're immediately just trying to get our next thing, next thing, next thing, when the opportunity to either get there quick or take the right road, we're generally going to pick the quick route because to us, quick becomes good, right? If we let that become our definition of good, and that's why the Bible talks a ton about patience and a ton about just accepting the situations we're in. And honestly, it helps because have you guys ever decided just not to be upset about something? Most of the time I forget that's an option, but you can choose just not to get worked up. And that's what God tells us to do because like truth, you know, because truth is so powerful and we have that opportunity, like Spider-Man says, who was my favorite superhero through pretty much all of high school, was great power, great responsibility, right? We have the opportunity to choose truth, but the problem is we actually have to choose it. And, you know, it's great responsibility because sometimes it's more difficult situations. Sometimes you get in fights with your family and friends because of truth. Sometimes that happens. But the mark of someone that's strong in their faith is someone that will choose truth even though it's not easy, right? It's easy to be the hero when you're on your couch and nothing's going on, but as soon as there's a burning building, everyone goes, well, what about him though? What about, you know, it's easy until, you know, the rubber hits the road. And, you know, truth is scary because we're not always sure of the outcome, right? It could be painful. There could be, like we said, arguments with family or friends that you could be fired, right? Let's say you see something at work and it's not good, that the boss is doing something bad, and you have the opportunity to keep your head down or say something. Even if you might be fired, the moral thing to do, the correct thing to do is to say something because even though you might lose your job, you have now bettered everyone else's, you know, situation, and you've also gotten something evil or something bad out of, you know, public space, which is good. So sometimes it's not the easiest thing. But in the end, truth glorifies God because it's the best outcome that in the long run. If God is truth and truth comes from God, then aligning the world and your life with truth means that you're glorifying God, saying, your will above mine, right? I'm not going to sit here and manipulate the world to try to fit my will. And that's one of the first things we have to learn about, you know, as Christians, is this idea that we're not here to manipulate the world. We're here to better the world through the kingdom of God. And so, you know, through truth, we learn new lessons, we meet new people in life and new opportunities, because what seems like a struggle now, you might meet someone or a new opportunity down the road because of the choice you made, because God doesn't just leave us out to dry. God says, I put a situation in front of you, you pick the right choice, I'm going to reward you for it, right? And even if it's not something in this life, right, it glorifies God, so that should be the only thing that matters to us, is that we're doing what's right in God's eyes. And so, and what's great is that God is loving, and he generally does reward us for doing the good things that we do, because that's the world we live in. I mean, think about like a child misbehaving, right? A parent loves a child, and so let's say, there's a lot of food analogies in this one, but let's say a kid ate a cookie out of the cookie jar, right? He tells his mom right away that he did it and doesn't try to lie to her, because she's going to find out, right? I've seen videos, hilarious videos of little kids trying to lie to their parents, and it's the funniest thing, right? The dog got up there and ate the cookie. So the dog picked up the cookie jar lid, put it down, got in there, grabbed the lid back on the jar. And so if the kid decides not to lie and tell the truth, he might get in trouble, but I guarantee it'll be less trouble than if he lied and did it. So telling the truth, even if it's hard in the beginning, even when we're little, it can actually be. We see that even at the most basic level, truth wins out over lying. So especially if you're a kid not good at it. So, and I was never good at it, sneaking down for sugar cubes in the middle of the night. And so this the truth that burns away the deceit in ourselves, it's really difficult because you know, it can be painful, but we aren't left alone, because when we burn away that falsehood, we're not just left, you know, afraid with nothing, because through Christ and his sacrifice, we have this new garb to put on, where we've lost that old, you know, dry straw that's burned away. Now Christ gives us that new nature to step into. So, you know, a lot of people, they're afraid to make that transition, to let go of the deceit in their lives, because they're afraid they'll have nothing left. But what's amazing about this relationship with Christ, and that's what we have to teach people, is that, guys, you're making the step, you're not alone, you're not going to be left out, just abandoned. God is giving you a new life to step into, and that's really important, because, you know, if we didn't have that new life to step into, we would have nothing. But because of Christ, you know, Christ is the way, the truth, and the life. Christ is the way to God. He's the truth, so if we follow his teachings, we'll get to the way that we're talking about, that path we're talking about. But he's also the life. Through his sacrifice, he gave us that new life. to live, because if we had this new life, we didn't have the way to truth, we'd just be lost. We'd be in some life where we'd be walking around. Christ gave us all three. He says, I'm going to give you the way to truth, I'm going to give you truth, and then I'm going to give you a new life to live out that new truth in. And so Christ gives us these amazing three things. But the thing is that truth can bring division, right? In Luke 12:51, we see that Christ says he's come to bring division into the world, not unify peace. But the thing about division itself is not bad, because you're cutting away, and you think about, right, you got a moldy muffin, right? You got a little mold on there, but it's still good. Again, food. I'm just going to embrace it at this point. We're talking about food. And so you cut off that moldy portion, and then you eat the rest, right? So division can even be division in cutting away the bad parts of who we are to get more in line with what God wants. And also, sometimes, bad people in your life, right? You know, let's say there's someone that's not working in your life. Telling the truth might be God's way of saying, confront it, and they'll get out of your life, right? You got to confront things in a Christ-like manner. But it could also be in a relationship where you finally confront the person about what's going on, and because you confront them now instead of putting it off, and you lived in truth, you were able to work it out and mend things, because God also helps us mend relationships instead of just get rid of bad ones as well. Because, you know, you tell the truth, you fight, and then you make up, right? That's what happens. Especially, I mean, that happens a lot when I leave my stuff out on the kitchen table. Frank lives in truth by confronting me quite often about that. And yeah, sometimes we bicker about it, but in the end I recognize that, yeah, I gotta move my Sonic bag because it's been there for 3 days and he's trying to eat dinner. And so what Christ did for us on the cross was, you know, he knew that plan. He knew what was going to happen to him, the pain that would come with it, but he lived in truth. He embraced God's will. I mean, even, you know, pray to God saying, look, if this is your will, I don't want it, but I'm going to take it, right? He gave us a direct example of what living in truth means, is that, I mean, he took the example, you know, my example is, I gotta go to work, but I don't feel like it. I could lie and say I'm sick and not go to work, or I can just fuck up and go to work. That, to me, is a big problem. But Christ took that to 11 and said, I'm going to die for you. I'm going to live in truth to the best example possible so I can give you the, you know, undefeated example of how to live in truth. And I think that's a beautiful thing because, you know, he embraced that anyway and lived out that truth. And so, you know, with that thought in mind of what Christ did for us, that example of living in truth, I wanted this week to try this exercise and next week maybe come together and talk about it. I want us to try to be more cognizant of the half-truths or the things that the little fibs we tell ourselves or other people in our lives, because it's surprising how many little things we can spot when we actually think about them or we got in our head. Like, for example, yesterday I tried this myself, and so Frank, we were getting ready to leave, and Frank was like, even the smallest things, like, he's like, you ready? And I'm like, get on my shoes. And I'm getting on my socks. And I'm like, get on my socks and my shoes. And then he knew better to then, okay, well, I got a second or two more to do this and that. Even from the smallest things on, if you think about it, you can catch where you're not quite saying exactly. Because what I was doing there, and what I thought about it was, I was trying to not get Frank mad at me, saying, like I'm, you know, slacking, not getting ready quick enough. So I said I was quicker than I was. And so even the small things, right? And if we think about it, then you kind of orient yourself and you'll notice how different your relationships are, how different your days are, when you're really looking out for those times where you're trying to, you know, pick the quick route out. And so think about that this week and try to see how your life improves when you try to look for those little inconsistencies. And because there's so much wonderful potential in living in truth, right? We see so many beautiful acts of courage, acts of kindness, love, and acceptance when people live in truth. And so if we start with the little things and work our way up to the big things, I'm excited to see the kind of potential for what we can find if everyone lived a little more in truth.
Amen. Amen. Please stand. Thank you, Reverend Flynn. It's amazing how you put things together, buddy. That's awesome.
Thank you.
Unconditional love lifts us up each day. Let us continue our thanksgiving with grateful hearts by giving of what God has provided.
Amen.
Please be seated for the offering.
Father, we need your help to hit the mark rather than living in sin, because most of the time our aim is not so good.
Almighty Father, please look over Jeff Bullock's father as he's been readmitted to the hospital due to his non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. Just please put your healing hands on him and support Jeff through his struggles.
I pray for our nieces and nephews who lost their brother, our nephew, and that you comfort them and be with them.
Father, we ask you to be with Ellie's sister and aid in all the healing she needs.
Lord, be with Jerry and Kathy and Ray and Carol. Watch over them.
Be with Jason as he battles cancer.
And Father, we're still hoping to find James. Thank you, Father.
Lord, I want to give you thanks for all the good things that have come into our life this week. Amen.
Lord, we just thank you for the good weather and the many blessings we have in this country. And like I say, even on a bad day, it's just good to be waking up in the good old USA, because we could be waking up in a very in more difficult circumstances throughout this world. So thank you, Lord, for this country. And all these things we lift up to you in your most precious name, and let's all say amen.
Amen. Amen.
Now, Lord Jesus Christ, in the night in which he was betrayed, took bread and he broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen. Please be seated. Come forward to give us direction. Remember, you come this way. Glass here, and there's a glass.
Thank you.
Stand. Now may the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ keep you in his love, grace, and truth. Amen.
Go and bear fruit. Go and do. Live a life that is worthy of the Lord. Give joyful thanks to God through loving your neighbor, through doing justice, through speaking out, and through defending those who are weak and oppressed.
Amen. Amen.
May God fill you with the knowledge of God's will. May Jesus Christ, who has rescued you, give you constant faith to speak the truth word of the gospel. And may the Holy Spirit guide you in wisdom and understanding so that the world can flower with the love of God.
Amen.
Love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you, folks. God bless you.